Hello. So I don't want to make many words. I'm very, very pleased to open this session here, which is at least to 50% for the summer students. So who is a summer student? Okay. You see the future? Maybe. Okay. It's to 60%. For the summer students, so I'm very happy to open this session. And to welcome five of the six astronauts. The other one is at the moment in space, not as high as normally. It's just on his flight from Italy to here, as far as I know. So the astronauts will afterwards sit here, but at the moment, in order to follow the first presentations, they will sit in the first row here. So it's my pleasure now to invite Professor Ting to tell us everything about AMS. So, some applause for
Where's the control? Where is the control? Good afternoon. It is a great pleasure for me to come here to welcome the six astronauts. And as I said last night, in 1994, when I began to think about this experiment, it was difficult for me to dream there would be today. The six astronauts are different from physicists. Physicists are supposed to be intelligent, have a good memory, but they have something more. They are exceptionally calm. And no matter what is the pressure, they seem to be very, very calm. And they are truly unusual people. Let's see, how do I move this?
Use the laser pointer. Use this one.
Okay. So let me just mention to you about the Science and the International Space Station. The International Space Station from here to here is 109 meters, from here to here is 80 meters, and namely 3 football fields. It has weight of 420 tons, and the cost is $10 to $11. This has received very strong support from US government, particularly from NASA, giving us 2 dedicated flights and a project office which show us how to change from high energy physicists to do experiment in space. The astronauts are very, very intelligent people. First time they visited us was in October 2009, and they have their priority right. First thing they want to do is to see Switzerland. And so they got off the airplane, went to the mountains. After that, they were happy to listen to Professor Scheer explaining AMS. So this is a international collaboration with 16 countries, 60 institutes, and 600 physicists. By current CERN standard, it is a very small experiment. From Spain, we have Mr. Aguilar. From Italy, Roberto Battistone. From Switzerland, Maurice Burkheim, Martin Paul. From Taiwan, Professor S.C. Lee. which both responsible for Taiwan and China, and Trent Martin from NASA, C.B. Roger from France, and Stephen Scheer from Germany. I dare say this is the only experiment I know where the space missile designers from China and Taiwan work together. This is not a cheap experiment, even by CERN standard. to send this experiment in space, we received very strong support from the United States House of Representatives, and particularly Mrs. Kelly, who is at this moment resting, and from the Senate. In 2009, a legislation, H.R. 6063, was unanimously approved by both House and requiring additional flight to deliver the Alpha Magnetic Spectrometer and other scientific equipment and payload to the International Space Station. It is rather seldom the Congress of the United States are involving in scientific experiments. So it is 5 meter by 4 meter by 3 meter, weighs 7.5 tons. It has 300,000 channel electronics, only 650 microprocessors. As all of you know, particles and nuclei are defined by their charge and energy. So on top is transition radiation detector, identify electron and positron. There are two layers of time of flight counter, measure charge and energy. A silicon tracker, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9, measure charge and energy. A ring image Cherenkov counter, measure charge and energy. An electromagnetic calorimeter, measure electron, positron, and gamma ray. Magnet, measure the sign of the charge. Therefore, energy and charge are measured independently by many detectors. As you know, in space, whether you are a summer student or not, if something goes wrong, you cannot send a student to fix it. The experiment is too large to be transported by a conventional airplane, and so we had to go to the United States Air Force to ask them to loan us a C-5, the largest airplane of its kind, and they agreed to it and sent the C-5 from United States to Geneva on the 25th of August, 2010. Once we sent to Kennedy Space Center, the first thing we did was to put this detector on the mock-up of the space station to make sure they can put together. If you don't do that, and if something doesn't fit in space, you will be somewhat unfortunate. So, in the meantime, the space shuttle was transferred to a vehicle assembly building, and then use a huge crane to assemble together with two solid rocket boosters and a liquid tank. On May 16th, last year, at 8:56 a.m., Captain Kelly and his crew left the Earth. At that moment, the total weight of the whole system is 2,008 tons. Our little experiment only weighed 7.5 tons. So this is not perhaps the most efficient system. But this is the best you can do with the current knowledge. So the astronauts, after 3 days, and they will explain to you, they successfully transfer us from the space shuttle to the space station. And The installation was completed at 5 a.m. after 4 hours of checking, we start collecting data. So the data from AMS goes to a Tesla satellite, then there's a Ku band and S band go to White Sands Terminal in New Mexico, then go to our computing system, the Marshall Space Flight Center, and then go to building 946 at CERN. We also have a computer on board, so an astronaut can store our data for up to 2 months in case the communication breaks down. So this is our park, and it's manned 24 hours a day, 365 days a year, because the space station is always there, and you have to be there all the time. So once you work on this, you have to change your concept about Christmas and New Year. A difficult issue I want to share with you is the thermal control. The major challenge of operating space is the extreme thermal environment to which the experiment is exposed. The AMS group developed computers which are programmable from CERN, and this computer read out 1,118 temperature sensors and control 300 heaters. And in addition, for the data acquisition, the total enormous amount of computers. For the TRD, there are 30 computers, for tracker, 200 computers, and so on and so forth. All the computers has fourfold redundancy. What are the thermal conditions? So the sun shining on the space station. When the sun is on this side, it's shining on the sunlight goes in here. When the sun is on top, it goes on the top. When sun goes in the bottom, it goes in this direction. In space, the temperature changes quickly. You rotate the Earth every 90 minutes. In addition, there's radiators who reflect the sun on AMS. Also, the arrival of the Soyuz or Progress also changes the thermal condition. In addition, there are solar panels, sometimes shade AMS. So the condition always changes. The computer enable us to keep the temperature stable to 1 degree. And this is the temperature. The outside temperature changes from minus 40 degrees C to plus 30 degrees C. And yet we're able to, with the computers, to control to 1 degree. And this is of great importance if you want to do a very precise experiment. So we use cosmic rays to align the detector. And the stability of the alignment of the silicon detectors is to 3 microns over 150 days. So accuracy is extremely important for a precise, for a precision detector. During the first year, detector functioned exactly as designed. We did not find any mishaps. We have collected over 18 billion events, up to trillion electron volts. In the next 10 to 20 years, we will collect hundreds of billions of events. And this will provide unprecedented sensitivity to search for new physics. One of the goals of AMS include a search for the origin of dark matter, which you must have listened to in your summer classes. We know 90% of the universe is not visible, and therefore it's called dark matter. A galaxy seen by telescope looks like this, but if you could see dark matter in the galaxy may look like this. What is cosmic ray? Cosmic ray means protons, electrons, and nuclei. Collision of the cosmic ray will produce, of course, positrons, electrons, and antiprotons. How do you search the origin of dark matter? Collision of dark matter will produce additional positrons. These additional positrons can be measured very accurately by this experiment. This is a 1.3 TeV electron. You trigger all the TRD, it means it's an electron. You measure 9 tracking points and show it's negative momentum, and you show the charge is negative, you know the momentum. Ring image Cherenkov counter measures charge, say it is 1. Electromagnetic calorimeter identify the shower direction, and this direction matches with the incoming, and this energy matches with this momentum. And this says it's an electron, this says it's an electron. And therefore you have a multi-redundancy to check it. We also see extremely high energy positrons. 250 GeV positron, 369 GeV positron, 424 GeV positron. So we're entering into a region nobody has been there before. Another physics example is to search for the existence of antimatter in the universe. The Big Bang origin of the universe requires matter and antimatter to be equally abundant at a very hot beginning. CERN, of course, is with a larger, larger accelerator, every approach the beginning of the Big Bang. If the universe indeed comes from a Big Bang, there should be somewhere antimatter universe. On the space station for 10 to 20 years, we searched for the existence of antimatter to the age of observable universe. This is why we built such a large and precise detector. Now, in order to see antimatter, the first thing you need to do is to show your detector can measure all the matter. So in the universe, there are helium, carbon. So in the anti-universe, there should be anti-helium, anti-carbon. Indeed, this is the measurement of different nuclei from periodic table, like this one, aluminum, with a momentum of 9 TeV. And this shows we indeed begin to map out the periodic table in space. Once you have done that, then you have confidence your detector can measure the antimatter, because that's the only difference is the charge. If you're not able to do this, then you will not know what you're doing. So this is the Scientific American. Shows people a big hope what is going on. The cosmos is the ultimate laboratory. Cosmic rays can be observed at energies higher than any accelerator. But the most exciting objective of AMS is to probe the unknown, to search for phenomena which exist in nature that we have not yet imagined, nor had the tools to discover. Why I say this? You can understand this very simply if you close your eyes and think about it. There are two kinds of cosmic ray traveling through space. Neutral cosmic ray, light rays, and neutrinos. Light rays has been measured over more than 50 years. All our understanding of the cosmos has come from fundamental discoveries from light rays. But beside light rays, there are charged cosmic rays. And this is a new region in science. The infrastructure on the International Space Station can support an accelerator-type magnetic spectrometer for precision, long-term, 10 to 20 years, study of high-energy charged cosmic rays. What does this mean? We have done a lot of work on this. We will continue to do so. But here, we just begin to open a door to go in to do a precision probe. So what we can see, nobody would know. This is why it makes science so exciting. And this was possible mainly because these five gentlemen here. Thank you.
So thank you very much. Can I now ask the five astronauts to come here? And to tell us everything about the rest around AMS, how it went up to space, etc. Can I hand over just to the Captain Mark Kelly, the boss of the group?
Thank you, Sue. Thank you. Hello, everybody. We've had a very enjoyable week here in Geneva and at CERN today. The weather's been perfect, and it's always nice when gravity's a nice, reliable 1G. You know, my crew and I and our families got to see the LHC today, and that was a pretty big highlight of our trip. It's a very impressive machine, and as all of you in this room know, has made some really remarkable discoveries. I'm certainly hopeful that AMS makes some equally remarkable discoveries. I have every confidence that it will. My crew and I, and I'm going to introduce them in a second, but we had the opportunity to fly the last flight of Space Shuttle Endeavour. Endeavour was built out of the spare parts that was left over after the Challenger accident. And it's been flying in space for about 18, 20 years. And we flew this mission we're going to talk about here briefly between May 16th and June 1st of 2011, and then basically parked Space Shuttle Endeavour, and it's going to go off to a museum. And that was one of the highlights of, I think, all of our astronaut careers. But another highlight was having the opportunity to deliver AMS to the International Space Station and get it successfully installed and get it working where Dr. Ting and his team took over once again. What is this? All right. All right, there's a crew. Myself, Greg Johnson, our pilot, colonel and test pilot. This is his second flight on Endeavour. And then Mike Fincke here, our MS. Mike did some spacewalks on this flight. He's also the American that has the most time in space at over a year. And then Drew Feustel was our lead spacewalker, and he's here today. He did three spacewalks during this mission. He also was involved in repairing a much less significant scientific instrument than the AMS, which is the Hubble Space Telescope. And then Greg Chamitoff on the end here, right below his picture. Greg is the only member of the crew I've flown with in space twice, and on my prior mission, his first, I closed the hatch on him and left him in space for 6 months. And then Roberto Vittori, who will be I think he's in Italy today. He'll be back maybe this evening, I think. Next slide. Here's a space shuttle. The orbiter there, Endeavour, the white piece is Endeavour, weighs about 200,000 pounds. And it's attached to a propulsion system and fuel that weighs nearly 4 million pounds. The external tank here that has liquid hydrogen and oxygen in it, and two solid rocket boosters. And all that stuff just is bolted to the launch pad. And we climb in the space shuttle about 3 hours before launch. Countdown clock's going towards zero, stops a couple times. We have an opportunity to think about whether the hatch is still open and we can get out or not. Then the clock gets to 6 seconds, main engines right here start, gets to 0 seconds, and these two solid rocket boosters light, and in an instant you jump off the launch pad. Incredible amount of vibration. It's like being on a runaway train going down the tracks at 1,000 miles an hour, and you just keep accelerating. It's really an incredible experience. Space shuttle, when you watch it on TV, looks like it's going up very smoothly. It's not smooth. We go from zero to 17,500 miles an hour in 8.5 minutes. Those solid rockets come off in about 2 minutes. When the main engine shut down 8.5 minutes into the flight, that external tank, the big orange tank, comes off, flies halfway around the planet, and hits the atmosphere over the Pacific Ocean. And because of some leftover fuel in it, explodes and the pieces fall in the Pacific. Here we are just shortly before or shortly after liftoff. In about 20 seconds into the flight, we go into the clouds and Dr. Ting couldn't see us anymore. And this picture was taken by a F-15 airplane before the solids come off. You can't see that they're on, but we can see that they are not falling behind us. So we just burst through the clouds, and we're on our way with AMS heading towards the International Space Station.
Thanks, Mark. Now we've all got to go through the education process as we figure this out. I think this is the button. Oh, yeah, there it is. What you see there is the International Space Station. It's a beautiful sight. We're about 1 mile away. We picked up the space station as a tiny little dot on the horizon as we approached it. And, oh, by the way, you can see the space station at night yourself. So, really, you know, the space station is visible from the naked eye just zipping around the Earth about 250 miles above the surface. So if you haven't seen it, which I bet many of you have, then you should take that opportunity. But as we get closer, we start seeing more and more detail of this beautiful laboratory, this zero-gravity laboratory. And as we approach, we can start to see detail. Here you can see through the overhead windows, this is the space shuttle cockpit. Here's Mark and here's Drew. And our mission is to join on top of this thing. And we're closing at very great rates. As we get closer, we get slower and slower. Eventually, we're just going 1 inch per second as Mark delicately attaches the space shuttle to the space station. We've been building the space station for over a decade, and you can start to see the handiwork of all the shuttle flights before us that have put this beautiful space station together. Here you can see out the overhead window the various modules aboard the space station. The center part of it, we can float from module to module, and you'll see that on the video that follows this presentation. And here we are attached to the space station. You can see the space shuttle Endeavour above, and we're actually all asleep aboard that space shuttle because this photo was taken by a Soyuz that was departing about 7 days after we got there. And so the six astronauts that are living on the space station plus the six astronauts in the space shuttle made a total of 12. But for a short period of time, there were just 9 of us. And right as they departed, they took this photo. I'm asleep sitting in there, and you can see all of the modules that we're going to be able to float through and see on the video. And here's the immense truss and the huge solar arrays of the space station, about twice the size, three times the size of a football field. And we enter into the space station for the very first time. Here you can see a few of the astronauts. The ones in blue are the ones that have been living there, astronauts and cosmonauts. And then we had just gotten to space. We weren't matching. We're a little bit disoriented. The other ones looked like seasoned camp counselors that had been in space for quite some time. This guy right here has a special part in my professional career, because I was an F-15 pilot in the Air Force, and he was a MiG-29 pilot. And so, in space, somebody that I trained to fight against now is my friend, and we're working together in space. Very rewarding for me. Well, as soon as we attached, we got to work. It's kind of like taking a Winnebago and parking it at somebody's house, plugging into their electrical power system, and then getting their lawnmower out and mowing their lawn. I mean, you know, we joined on the space station, we shook hands, we had our safety briefing, and then we went to work. We had three payloads, but only one of them was primary. I'd like to point out the other two, and then I'll pass it off to Spanky. This is the ELC-3. It's a pallet that had a bunch of spare parts, and we used robotics to attach the ELC on top of the truss. And then, of course, the AMS is back there, and Spanky will talk about that. And then finally, this big, long boom was the final piece that we attached to the space station, and you'll see that in the video. Now I'll pass it off to you, Mark.
Looks like I figured out how to do this, huh? It's good to see everyone. I think during our week here, we got to meet with a lot of you, even if it was just at the autograph session. And we can't express how glad we are to be here in this area, Geneva, and as part of France also. Also, CERN is... this is where astronauts want to go when they grow up. I mean, this is a really cool place, all right? And you guys are really lucky, especially you students here. So make the most of your opportunity. Just as we tried to do when we were in space, we tried to make the most of our opportunity up there. We had a difficult, not a difficult process, we made it look easy, but it was a complex process of getting the Alpha Magnetic Spectrometer from the back of the space shuttle to the truss of the International Space Station. First off, Dr. Ting, don't let him fool you. He's really smart. He and his team had a beautiful design. If any of you have a laptop, you understand the concept of plug and play. So what we did was, all we had to do, very simple, right, to take the AMS out of the payload bay of the shuttle, put it onto the truss, close hit a few switches. There would be a claw to hold it down, and a few umbilicals to come and to take power and data channels. Simple as that. Plug and play. No extra vehicular activity required. That means we didn't have to go out and put a spacewalk and put the wires together. It was a very interesting design. We trained for it for a long time. We had two guys, I think it was Dr. Feustel and Roberto Vittori, working the Canadian robotic arm from the space shuttle. Look at that, there's a laser there. And they picked up the Alpha Magnetic Spectrometer. And they used a process, I think Roberto calls it a handshake in space, where they took it out to empty space, and then the box man and Greg Chamitoff picked it up with the station robotic arm. We have two, one for the shuttle, one for the station. And the station robotic arm picked it up from the empty space. The shuttle robotic arm let go, and the station put it on top of the truss. A few more computer switches and plug and play, and Alpha Magnetic Spectrometer was connected and came to life quickly afterwards. Let me go back 1 second. The International Space Station is a collaboration of 15 countries working together. The Alpha Magnetic Spectrometer is are 16 countries working together. And here at CERN, it's many, many countries working together. And more countries are on their way. This is amazing. If we look back at the previous century and see how the countries of the world did not always get along very well, now we are working together. Now we are doing things that are constructive and not destructive. And I congratulate you all for understanding that and being part of it, because it's really cool. So we talked a little bit about how we got the Alpha Magnetic Spectrometer sitting there. I'd like to point out, you'll see this a little bit in the video that we're showing, these yellow stanchions here, those are called handrails because we use those when we go on spacewalks. You could also see that there's some handrails that are really close to this beautiful Alpha Magnetic Spectrometer. Well, Professor Ting and his team told us that we must not kick it. So we were very careful because we could not afford the bill if they sent us the repair bill. So we were very careful when we were outside near the Alpha Magnetic Spectrometer. Inside, though, there was a lot of other work to do. We finished with the Alpha Magnetic Spectrometer. It took 6 or 7 hours of our time. In the meantime, we have Colonel Johnson here, the box man, Roberto Vittori, also known as Ricky Bobby, and working together. This is a special payload that came from the Italian Space Agency, ASI, and we worked on a lot of other payloads, a lot of other science while we were up there. They made every minute in space count. And you can see there's Roberto. He's in the European Automated Transfer Vehicle, the ATV, and his job was to pack it up full of things, mainly trash, that was going to go back through the atmosphere and burn up. And he did a great job with that. And he also, Ricky Bobby, was our loadmaster, and he packed up all of the things that we were bringing back from the space station, and we made sure it got packed correctly and brought it back home. And then it was a special moment because through the connections of some of our crewmates, we had were able to, for the first time, have an audience with the Pope in Rome. This is Pope Benedict XVI, and he was able to talk to us and ask us a few questions, and we had a chance to talk back to him. And the one thing, and you'll hear this in the video, and it really made a difference to us. And you know, we're tough, big astronauts. You know, we don't take advice a lot, but when Pope Benedict talked, we listened, and he said that he was really glad for what we were doing for the future of humanity. And that made a big difference. And again, what you do here at CERN, what you do back at your own universities and institutions, what we do aboard the International Space Station, it's for humanity. And with that, I present my spacewalking buddy, Dr. Drew Feustel.
In addition to the work that we did inside the space shuttle and space station, we also had some work to do outside. So over the course of our 16-day mission, myself, Mike Fincke, and Greg Chamitoff did 4 spacewalks. Each time we went outside in the spacesuit, we spent between 6.5 and 8 hours outside working together as a team. We spend roughly a day getting ready for each mission. Each time we go outside, that involves gathering tools and getting our bodies ready for the low pressure of the suits and the high content of oxygen that we breathe while we're outside. This is a great picture that really indicates how large the space station is with respect to us. This is me hanging off the top of the one of the truss segments, and here's Greg Chamitoff camouflaged here on the other part. And it's easy for us to get lost out there. We trained for this mission for almost 2 years together, and much of the time was spent in an underwater environment at the Johnson Space Center training to go out in our spacesuits. So for every hour that we spent out in space, which was about 28 hours or so over the 4 days, we trained for over 200 hours underwater in our spacesuits getting ready for the mission. And the main reason we do that is because we don't like to make mistakes. It's very costly, and we also don't want to get lost when we're outside. So it's really important for us to get familiar with the structure and the area that we're going to be working in, so that when we go outside that we know where we're going, we know what we're doing, and we get everything done in the time that we have to do it. The spacesuits that we wear weigh about 300 pounds or 150 kilograms on Earth. In space, of course, they don't weigh anything, but they still have inertia, so it's important for us to move slowly and learn to work in them. They're pressurized to 4.3 pounds per square inch relative to the vacuum of space. So in the vacuum of space, they're actually at 4.3 pounds per square inch inside. That makes the legs and arms and gloves all very hard to move. We don't use our legs when we walk, work in space. We just use our hands as we move around the space station structure. And the gloves are sort of like wearing 5 or 6 pairs of gardening gloves on your hands and going outside to plant seedlings in the ground. That's kind of the equivalent of the work that we do. But with enough practice and familiarity with the gloves, you kind of learn to work with them and learn to accommodate for the challenges that they present. It's hard work. It's very hard work, and I guess I mentioned that we spend between 6.5 and 8 hours in the suit, but it's also a lot of fun. And if you look closely in this image, you can see Mike Fincke with a big smiling face. We really enjoy the opportunity and the privilege of being outside. There's really no view quite like the view that we have as spacewalkers. Sorry, guys. When we're outside looking down at the Earth with just the visor separating you from the vacuum of space, but it was really a privilege for us to be there, and we really enjoyed the time we spent outside. And I'm going to pass it on to Greg.
I also like to take a second to say that it's very special for us to be here. We were here as a crew about 3 years ago. To learn about AMS, and you know, this was an opportunity for the AMS team and Dr. Ting to explain to us, you know, here's what this thing is, here's what it does, here's what you shouldn't touch, you know, here's, take a look at this, don't break that, and for the team to get it comfortable with us that we're going to listen to them and be careful with their baby, and it became our baby as well. And so it's really wonderful us to be back now and to share the success, and you know, and now we're all one big happy family, and it's a really spectacular joint success. All of you in your mind, you know you're on a big round rock floating in space, but when you see it from this perspective with your own eyes, it's just unbelievable. This was the first time. After 6 months on the space station on a previous flight, this was still my first time getting outside on a mission. And it's unbelievable to just look at the whole Earth with your own eyes. You have this reality in your mind that you know the Earth is round, you know it's floating through space, and then you see it with your own eyes. And it's this confirmation of reality that's just unbelievable. When you're out there, like this, it's you and your buddy, the space station below, and then below that, you know, the whole Earth. And this was actually during the last spacewalk of our mission. And it's the last, in fact, the last spacewalk of the whole shuttle program. It was Mike and I. And Mike and I got to close the hatch on the last spacewalk of the space shuttle program. It was also the last spacewalk to finish the assembly of the space station. This was another objective of our mission. In addition to installing AMS, we finished the assembly of the space station. And I'll show you in the next picture here. During this spacewalk, we got to climb to the highest point on top of the space station, look at the whole thing, and take this panoramic picture. And you can see here over on the left side, let me back up one here. You can see over here on the left side, this is the shuttle's nose sticking out. All the way on the right is that automated transfer vehicle, the European cargo vehicle you've heard about a little bit. This is sort of the main corridor of the space station. It's distorted from a wide-angle camera here. This is a football field in length. And then all the way across the truss here, and that white thing way over there, that's AMS, actually. But it was a spectacular moment that we got to share with all the control centers around the world. As Mike mentioned, it's 16 different countries working on this for 12 years, 36 shuttle flights. Mark got to announce space station's assembly is complete. And so we got to share this wonderful moment of the success of the building of the space station, which, in addition to AMS, which is definitely the crown jewel of the space station, has hundreds of other experiments, and really now is running full steam with 6 people on board with a real focus on science. I'd like to show this picture to you because I've taken about 22,000 pictures in space, and this is one of my very favorites. And if you can believe it, this was my bedroom view during this mission. And I told these guys before the mission that this is where I'm sleeping. I got dibs on this spot. This is in the Japanese module right by one of the windows. And what I usually did is I put my sleeping bag on the wall right there. And there's a shutter you can open, you know, that opens to the outside and then exposes the view. And I would just sit there staring at this view until I really had to go to bed. And it just, the feeling I got when I looked out the window and I saw this, of course, it was the beautiful planet that we live on, and the spectacular stars, and all the things that we don't know, and all the ultimate unknown. But it really was. We have this platform. We have this stepping stone. We have the space station that's flying above everything we know, and between that and everything that's the future and the unknown that we have to explore. And it's a wonderful place, the space station, and the space station itself is really the legacy that the shuttle leaves behind. This is the last landing then of Endeavour. Mark made a beautiful landing, and it was a spectacular mission, unbelievably successful considering all the things we got done, and really without any problems, any significant problems at all. And the shuttle was in a really amazing vehicle. We learned so much about how to do things in space, how to live and work and build and fly and operate and do science in space from the space shuttle. And now we have the space station up there, and hopefully that will continue the legacy and allow us to continue to learn and expand our species into the cosmos. So this is our presentation. We'd like to now show you a spectacular video. We think it'll give you guys the feeling of what it's like to really be up there with us. So enjoy this, and then we'll be happy to take your questions at the end.
Looks cool.
Hey, I've got a pair of those.
Podcast.
This is the cupola. The UMA mate is complete, and with that, the ELC-3 is successfully installed.
For the great ride and safe delivery of AMS to the station.
Well, thank you, Sam. I was just looking out the window of the orbiter, and AMS looks absolutely fantastic on the truss.
We are here in the Vatican together with His Holiness, Pope Benedict the 16th.
Welcome aboard the space station, Your Holiness.
You have helped me and many other people to reflect together on important issues that regards the future of humanity. I wish you the very best for your work and for the success of your great mission at the service of science, international collaboration, authentic progress, and for peace in the world.
Use a very ultralight ninja graceful ballerina grip, as we talked about. ET2 is ready with ninja ballerina grip.
Endeavour departing. Fair winds and fallen sea sky. CFX rod
of blue.
It's a pleasure serving with you, boys. Go Navy.
Up through the stony ground, there's no room.
See, as we come up on about our 200th sunrise of the mission, we can clearly see AMS now on station and ELC-3. Just want to congratulate the whole team on the ground and the Expedition 27 and 28 crews for all the hard work that you guys have put into this. We're the ones that get to see this incredible view, but you know, you're all with us in spirit, and this is really a new day for science aboard the space station. So thanks to all of you.
Endeavour runway in sight. 122 million miles flown during 25 challenging space flights. Your landing ends a vibrant legacy for this amazing vehicle that will long be remembered. Welcome home, Endeavour.
Thank you. Thank you very much. That trip was, I think, about 6 million miles, 200 and what?
48.
248 times around the planet. And we very thankfully got AMS installed, and it's, as Dr. Ting tells us, it's still working today, so we're very happy about that. Now we have some time to take some of your questions. I think we have about 10 minutes, 10 or 15 minutes.
Hello. I was wondering. Hello. I was wondering if you have running water, and if you're there for like 6 months, how do you wash your clothes?
Okay. So let's see. We do not. We do not have running water. We do not have a really good way to bathe. So we get a some water. We wipe ourselves from head to toe with a washcloth and maybe some soap. And our clothes, we wear them until they smell bad, much like college students do, university students. Except that then we throw them away, and because NASA will provide us more, apparently. So that's life aboard space station, including for the long duration missions, including for 6 months.
Question for Professor Ting, if I may. Which was a bigger highlight, winning the Nobel Prize or seeing your wonderful experiment on the ISS?
It's hard to make a difference. I received the Nobel Prize when I was quite young. Probably the Nobel Committee had the excitement overclouded their judgment. having received the Nobel Prize at a young age has helped me enormously to do many experiments, and has not hurt to have AMS to go to space. Thank you.
Hello. Yesterday, a couple of days ago, we have the anniversary of Apollo mission, and I figure out that most of you were young when that happened, and must be your inspiration to become an astronaut. So now, how you see the future of space? How the young today will aspire to be?
In fact, you're probably right on for many of us. I was almost 7 years old and just happened to be in Florida at the time of the launch of Apollo 11. And I was actually on the beach, and I was climbing on we call it a jungle gym, right, at bars, by a beach, watching the launch. And I told my dad then that this is what I was going to do. And now my son is 7 years old, and he sees all this going on, and my daughter as well, and I'm, who knows what they're going to do, but I think these are very inspiring, moments in our history, and I think those moments in our history is, when they happen at the right age, and especially when there's a mentor, a parent, a teacher that brings it and exposes it to a child, and also later in years when later for me in college there was my college graduation. Just by chance, I didn't even know it was coming, but it turned out that the graduation speaker was an astronaut, and so I got to meet my first astronaut at my graduation, and I thought, wow, well, this person went to my school, maybe it's really possible. So I don't know, when we travel around, we find there's a lot of enthusiasm. Kids are very excited, and it's the teachers that really help convey that and excite the kids. So we just have to keep getting out there and try to inspire the next generation. But I think these anniversaries and these moments are very, very important for inspiration.
Hi. In the video, we saw the shuttle launch, and I noticed it spins as it goes up. I was wondering, A, is that intentional? B, if so, and I'm hoping it is, what's that for? And C, do you notice that side of the spinning? Because you said it wasn't smooth. And yeah.
We do the roll program so that we get a little better view of the Earth as we... My first roll program was at night, so I didn't have the pleasure of looking outside, so I have to admit, during the roll program, it was quite spectacular to see the Earth. But the real reason we do that is for communications, nothing else. It's just to work the communication system.
How and why were you chosen to be the astronauts that went up?
yeah. As Mike said, good looks, and we're all a band of misfits. it's difficult to know exactly why crews are chosen. I think the way that my understanding is the way it initially starts out is that a commander is chosen for a flight, and the commander has some influence on the rest of the crew. It also is a function of availability for the remainder of the astronauts. We have a limited number of astronauts, and a certain number are assigned at any given time. So when it comes time to pick a crew, you look at personalities for people getting along together. You look at skill mix, robotics, EVA, and you also look at availability, and then the influence by the commander's decision. So I don't think it's a real well-known science, but there is a little bit of quantitative thought put into it, but maybe not a lot. Gravity sucks.
Actually, I think it's a scalar field.